Welcome to George Mason University's Studio A. My name is Rick Davis, and today our guest is Mark Peterson, executive producer of the 2011 film At the Top of the Pyramid. Please welcome Mark Peterson. Mark, thanks for being here.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Great. You bring to Studio A just your average filmmaker's background, career degrees in international relations, and a career in the energy industry. Can you talk a little bit about how that started and how you made the transition into the film world?
Right. About 28 years in the energy business, and the last 10 years of that, I started thinking about ideas and concepts. And I'm not going to say I hit a midlife crisis, but I think I hit the big 5-0, and I thought, you know something? I want to do something different.
Huh.
And so I simply walked away from one chapter in my life and began a new chapter in my life.
And you had actually started thinking about that years before?
Yes, I've spent a number of years developing ideas, writing them down. I'm not going to say creating treatment because I didn't know what a treatment was,
right.
But concepts. And so when I actually left the energy business, I had a library of ideas to go back to and say, all right, which am I going to develop into treatments and then write scripts.
Wow. And did the fact that your father was a network television director have anything to do with that?
I'm not sure it had anything to do with it other than I wasn't intimidated by walking into a studio. I was comfortable around cameras and basically being on a set on a stage. That wasn't new to me. But I hadn't been there for 25 years. And things had changed
yes.
in a quarter century.
Yeah, indeed. So tell me about how you developed this idea and how you sort of took it from something that wasn't quite a treatment into production.
Well, the idea was about 3/4 of a page that I had developed in 2005 after listening to a colleague of mine saying that his daughter had been made a flyer and I didn't know what a flyer was. He explained to me that's the girl who's thrown up in the air. So at lunchtime that day, I literally came up with a story, wrote it down. And then in the autumn of 2009, I had about a dozen different projects that I was working on with an associate, Richard Willis Jr., who was my writer and co-executive producer, music producer, everything in this project. But at the time, he was just helping me develop my ideas. And I actually had a son who passed away. My second son was given six weeks to live and lived 21 years. Mm. And going through that experience, seeing him overcome obstacles, made me think about the fact that all of us overcome our obstacles. Every day is overcoming obstacles. We each have our own goals to meet, and we each are climbing our own pyramids. And the pyramid was a metaphor for just overcoming what we each have to journey through to get to the top.
Mm-hmm.
And we each have our own journey. And so that was a nod to my son, who had, again, overcome all the odds in his own way. And so I selected that story among my library of options.
And did you develop it in the form of a screenplay, or did you write it out?
Yes. I developed a story thinking of an MOW, Movie of the Week, a movie made for television.
Mm-hmm.
So I created the story, created the characters, and then brought in this gentleman I mentioned earlier, Richard Willis Jr., who's a vetted Emmy award-winning writer, and then he took my story and characters and he came up with the script.
Wow. So at that point you sort of transitioned into an executive producer role?
That's exactly right, yeah. Which was really not my intent. I didn't leave the energy practice to be an executive producer. I really wanted to be a writer. But the fact is, when you put out your first product, you want somebody who has been vetted and is recognized as a writer. There are enough obstacles to go against any first-time executive producer, much less a first-time writer. I gave Richard the opportunity, and he just did a tremendous job with the script.
And did you keep collaborating on it as it went forward?
Yes, because with Richard, I got not only a writer and a co-executive producer, but he's also extremely versed in the music arena.
Uh-huh.
So I got a music producer, and when you make a movie aimed at the teenage market, music has got to be hot. And in our case, we have 22 original songs in the soundtrack.
Original songs?
Yes.
Created, that means created for the,
correct,
the show. Wow.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Right, right.
That seems like a whole project in and of itself.
It was. The good news for us is that studios and distributors nowadays, they look for multiple streams of revenue. So to say they're going to make money off the movie is one thing, but then when you say, hey, I've got a soundtrack, they look at it as saying, well, you have two assets. So we have two assets, and we shot a music video for our first song that's going to be released at the end of April of this year, 2012.
Oh, terrific.
So literally in 3 or 4 weeks.
So that's going to be a promotional for the movie as well as a moneymaker.
Exactly. I mean, it should, our goal is to have it stand and be successful in its own right. At the same time, the music video has a theme that is drawn from the movie, which is anti-bullying, because our lead character comes back and she's the subject of, shall we say, intimidation. Mm. She's not welcomed with open arms by everybody. And you see emotional bullying going on in the movie and how she overcomes that. So we're able to take that theme out of the movie, put it under a music video, and it happens to be a newspaper topic right now.
Oh, this is such a huge
issue.
Yeah,
exactly. So we're getting a lot of support from various organizations simply because our music video has that theme.
Oh, that's great. And obviously that'll help with eventual distribution, probably.
We certainly hope so.
Yeah, that's great. Talk a little more about the executive producer role and sort of the range of tasks that you set for yourself.
Well, you know, in the typical film, the executive producer is the business guy, all right? So, you know, I would look at it and say that as an executive producer, you could never leave your office. You could never be, you don't have to be on the set. You don't have to be talking to the actors. You don't have to be talking to the crew. I mean, you are literally behind the scenes. In this project, that was not the case at all because I was a story by guy,
yeah.
All right? And in fact, the script that Richard Willis Jr. wrote, he's a dramatic writer. I tend to be more humor. So I took his script and I added in the humorous elements. So it was Richard and I who were really the creative team, which is not typically what the executive producer does. All right, so that made it where it was frustrating for me because on a typical set, if the executive producer shows up, that means there's a problem. That literally means it gets the crew is upset, the actors are nervous. Why is the executive producer here? Well, I'm there because I have another hat, all right? So I'm wearing multiple hats. Yeah. So it was a balance that I had to play during the shooting. So I didn't make people uncomfortable. At the same time, I had multiple roles to play, some of which required me to be on the set.
Yeah, and including finance and all the...
Yeah, well, that didn't require me to be on the set. That required me to be at the bank.
Right. Very good. We have a short clip from the film. It's a teaser, really,
mm-hmm.
About 90 seconds long. Can you tell us what we're about to see and how you sort of compiled that?
The first thing you're going to see is Jamie Parker, our lead, speaking in a memorial service for her father. And I can't say too much about it because it is a very critical part of the movie. It is a memorial service for her father who had been a community leader and had lost his life in a plane crash and they were holding a service for him. So she's speaking there. And then I believe you have a locker room scene.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And this gives you an idea of what I referred to earlier is not everybody was thrilled with her return. Mm-hmm. Because the story has to do with one of the things she has to overcome is that she had suffered a bad fall. And the question is, was that truly an accident or was there some overt intentional action behind it? So this is something mm-hmm. that you have to mm-hmm. to watch for.
And then there's a brief third clip. I think it's in a living room or kitchen.
Oh,
setting.
Oh yeah. This is where, you know, they're moving back. She and her mother had left the area, which is this area, which is Northern Virginia. The father had died. They decided to move back to the family home. And they're moving back into the house. And her friends have showed up to the house to help her unpack and to, quote, welcome her. Mm-hmm. And then an argument ensues, and you see a little bit of that.
So we're just going to get kind of a little smorgasbord salad bar.
It's truly called a teaser. We haven't even done a trailer, because the trailer is not typically done until you have an agreement with your distributor or the studio. And because we're in negotiations, and they always want to have a say in what's in the trailer.
Sure.
So we developed this little teaser. So you have a piece of the teaser.
Very good.
All right.
Okay, and let's watch the teaser.
My dad was a kind man. He had courage. He believed in me. And he taught me to believe in myself. We have the state qualifiers next week. And rather than honor my dad with a sad ceremony, I plan to go there and kick some cheerleader butt. That's what I think he would want me to do. So that's what I plan to do. Go there, win, and make him proud.
Everybody's going to Joe's Cafe tonight. If you newbies plan to come hang out and be in our clique, you might want to consider voting for Diana.
Diana, but she wasn't even
talking to you, Kelly. We all know whose ass your lips are kissing.
You know, I'm surprised you're even allowed back on the squad, but to think that we would make you the captain?
I think she's talking about me.
Yeah, you, and you, and you, and even you, Miss Parker.
You want me to vote for you.
I want you to vote for who you think is best.
I was talking about when Jamie fell at the Children Championships.
Oh, damn, you fell?
No, she was dropped.
Oh, not cool.
Look,
CW.
Fell, dropped. She got hurt, and we got beat. That's all I know.
So, back from the salad bar. Very, very nice little snippets of film there. Obviously, very high quality production. Did you how did you assemble your crew and the, all of the various craft areas as a first-time executive producer?
Well, the crew, the first thing we did was hire a director. Mm-hmm. You want to bring your director in early on, and we did that several months before principal photography was set. And then we left it up to her to bring on above-the-line crew members. And, we thought we had all the key positions filled. And then things started to go, shall we say, astray.
Yes, tell us a little bit about that.
Well,
going astray.
First of all, your shoot schedule is set by your AD, your assistant director. We went through four ADs over a period of 3 weeks.
Wow.
Simply because you're a first-time executive producer, you're quote-unquote low budget, and as soon as people committed, they got something else going, and boom, they're gone. And so we show up, my actors show up, my crew show up, and we have no shoot schedule.
Hmm.
That's a little problem. But really the biggest problem, I think, was on the fourth day of shooting, and it was a very important scene. One of our stars, Steve Guttenberg, was in the scene. And I was in my office at my home getting phone calls periodically. Well, how, you know, where it's going well, where we're a little bit behind. Well, we've caught up and now things are going well. Well, finally, about 7 p.m., I couldn't take anymore. I needed to show up and see for myself how things were going. So I show up and I ask to speak to my director, and I'm told that she left. And I said, she left? I said, have we broken for lunch? The second meal of the day, no matter when it is lunch. So have we broken for lunch? No, she just left. I said, well, when is she coming back? We don't think she is.
Whoa.
So sure enough, my director had walked off the set. So I find myself at a bar on a Friday night of Father's Day weekend with Steve Guttenberg and my attorney, I guess one or two others, and we're basically going through, okay, what do? We have no director. And over the next 48 hours, we're on the phone and I'm interviewing directors in different cities around the country. You know, New York, San Francisco, L.A., we did not lose. We lost a little bit of time, but the next day we were shooting. My co-executive producer, Richard Willis Jr., again, he stepped in. He had directed some documentaries. He stepped right in. We had a meeting with the crew, meeting with the cast. The cast was devastated because the director and the cast, they're the only ones that are communicating on set, all right? It's that relationship that is a bond that you really do not want to interfere with. And particularly with a young cast, inexperienced cast that we had, they were relying on the director to literally be there and support them, and now she's gone.
Wow.
No director.
Yeah.
So we had to pull ourselves together. The cast, you know, did what they needed to do to be professional like that. The crew went on, and the new director came in, and we shot for another 5 weeks.
Oh, that's fantastic. And I imagine there must have been a tremendous sense of let's pull together and get this thing
there was,
back on track.
There was. And, you know, there were constant issues, constant problems from the standpoint of, you know, you plan your day, but then little things go wrong. Like, you know, somebody's driving in a stake to hold up one of the light scaffoldings, and he hits an irrigation line. All of a sudden, we've got water shooting 6 feet up into the air.
All Work right? it in.
So you go, now what do we do? All right. So, yeah, we had constant things to deal with. But at the end of the day, we got it done. We got it done.
You have some relatively big name actors in this cast, and you have a lot of young sort of people mm-hmm. making either their debut or at least early,
yes.
early career. How did those worlds blend for you?
We had two casting directors, one here in Falls Church, Virginia, and one in L.A. And we got our two name actors, Steve Guttenberg and Dean Cain, out of L.A. We got all our cheerleaders, most of our cheerleaders, from our Northern Virginia casting director, came from the Washington metropolitan area. Our young actors came from New York, Washington, and L.A.
Wow, that's a great opportunity to get an ensemble like that together.
Mm-hmm.
And did it blend pretty seamlessly? Did you have to?
Yes. No. They, you know, because they were all young and because they were all starting out, to them it was, you know, going to camp, except mm-hmm. it's real.
Yeah.
All right. And I said earlier, I used the term low budget. Low budget. That sounds like you could put all those young actors in a pup tent and feed them spaghetti three times a day, and I would have met SAG requirements, all right, Screen Actors Guild. But that's not what we did. We put them up in a Marriott hotel. We had craft services that was first class. I mean, we treated them as if they had been acting for 15 or 20 years. And in fact, when Steve Guttenberg and Dean Cain were on the set, they ate with the crew and the cast.
Yeah, I was wondering. I mean, that's a great thing, right, in and of itself, to create that
right.
ensemble feeling and that bonding.
Right.
That's great. If you don't mind saying, who was the director who came in and finished the job?
Larry Jordan. Mm-hmm. Larry Jordan out of San Francisco. And his background, he's actually had done a lot of music videos. But you say, well, why did you bring him in to do this sort of movie? Well, we wanted that kind of quick, up-tempo feel to the whole thing.
And you knew that music would be a big part of
and
it.
Movie, yeah. And the music was a big part of it. Also, Larry, the great thing about Larry Jordan was that he came in, he understood that he came in to fulfill somebody else's vision.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the most difficult thing, because if you're a director, you're a director because you have a vision and you want to execute it on film. He came in and had to execute somebody else's vision. But he was such a great team player. He would take our vision, he'd add his own elements, imaginative, creative guy. But ultimately, he's putting somebody else's vision on the screen.
That's terrific. Not easy to do.
Not easy to do.
Very good. Well, we have some students who I'm sure have some questions for us. So let me turn to the studio audience here and see if anybody has a question. Yes, over here.
Hello, my name is Garrett. From the sound of it, you deal with a lot of stress in your job, but what is some of the most rewarding parts of it?
Well, I think the rewarding part, it goes back to the young actors. You know, each of them had an opportunity to be in a feature film, and even though some of them had, they all had some acting experience, this was the first feature film for all but two of them, I believe. And so I saw them grow in a period of 6 weeks. They went from, you know, true novices to experienced actors. And that to me was very rewarding.
Great. Another question from the studio audience, perhaps over here. Yes, sir.
Yeah. I don't know if it's, I was wondering what sort of budget were you working with, or was that not?
The budget. We had a budget. We blew by the budget. We came up with another budget. We blew through that. You know, I don't want to get into numbers, but the fact is that it turned out to be, well, first of all, if you go into Hollywood and you have any movie under $10 million, they think it's low budget. But if you go to SAG, you have all sorts of categories, from 200 to a million to 3 million. You have different levels. So, you know, we're under that $10 million range by far. All right. But again, by Hollywood standards, that's nothing. That's craft services on John Carter.
Do we have another question? Yes, sir.
It sounds like your cast and crew worked really well together. They had some good cohesion. Would you say that was essential to the success of the film?
Oh, it's always, yes, it is essential. The one thing that I learned is the respect that everyone gives to everybody else on the set. In fact, I was the one who periodically, because of I'm looking at time, and time is literally money. So I already said we blew by one budget and then blew by another budget. So I'm the one who's kind of antsy, and yet everybody else would remain cool, treat everybody with respect. Maybe it's taken twice as long to strike or set up a set, but everybody is very respectful that the other person is an artist. You might think that the gaffer or the grip or the best boy or whatever, they're just, you know, equipment people, whatever, but they are artists. They see themselves as artists, and they are artists. And so you have to treat them as such.
That's great. Another question, please. Yes, in the back.
Hi, I'm Dave. And I'm curious about what ended up happening to your first director that walked off the set. I imagine that there were contracts signed and that kind of thing, and that seems like a huge no-no, at least that we're taught here. So I'm curious about what ended up happening.
All I will say is that she got on a plane and headed west. And there are no contractual issues involved. That's all I can say about that.
Okay. Very good. Do we have another question? Over here, perhaps? No more? Going once? Going twice? Okay. Well, I've got a few. We talked in the green room, actually, about one of the unexpected joys of being an executive producer that you ended up having to fulfill was that of location scout, which included using your own home.
Mm-hmm.
And this film was shot here in Northern Virginia primarily, or
right.
exclusively.
Right.
Tell me about how that aspect of the work ended up affecting your job as executive producer.
Well, first of all, you're always looking how to save money. And I said, well, fine, the Parker home can be our house. That seemed like a good idea. And in all pre-production meetings, I said, we're not going to use a third floor, the bedroom floor. We can use here and here and here. And I'm going to skip to the morning where there's a scene where we had to use the room, which we had been using for makeup and wardrobe. Well, the only room that was not being used at the time was the master bedroom, where, of course, I and my wife of my former wife now. No, she's still with me. My
she's
wife sleep,
going
right?
Yeah, right?
And so at approximately 5:45 a.m., I am waking my wife up to say that she needs to get up because we need to use the master bedroom for hair, wardrobe, and hair and makeup. And she goes running out, and literally they are coming into the bedroom as she is getting out of bed. So that was it was a an experience. This is why people who use their house, they only do it one time.
Yeah, I was going to say, I've heard.
Yeah, you do it one time, right. And you never do it again.
Right. Very good. Right. And then what about like the locker room and stuff? Was that an actual high school
Yeah, we
room?
Used, I wanted to use the school. This is set around Centerville High School in Clifton. And my kids went there, and I knew a lot of people there. I knew the administration. The administration wanted to have it there. The bottom line is Fairfax County has hourly rates, and they don't care whether you are Slamgate Productions, a small independent, or your Universal Studio. You will pay $400 an hour. That wow. was not in the budget. I considered that a wow number, too.
Yeah, I want to get in the locker room rental business.
Yes, right. So the movie was shot at Bishop O'Connell in Arlington and at Paul VI in Fairfax. Mm-hmm. Because they're both parochial private schools. They were happy to get a check, because obviously I paid for their space, but I didn't have to pay that kind of rate.
Fantastic.
And that was it.
Well, Mark, this has been a real pleasure, a real behind-the-scenes look at a process that's been, I think, both revelatory, obviously, for you and now for us. So thank you for being on Studio A.
Thank you. I appreciate the invitation.
My pleasure.
Thank you so much.
I'm Rick Davis. This is George Mason, Studio A. Thanks for watching.